darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the see you.
Every Sunday should feel like Easter Sunday, right? Because he is risen. He is risen indeed. And this jacket was on sale. So thank you all for, I just couldn't wait till next Easter. It's Easter every Sunday. I said it. I got to live into what I say as a pastor. So I thank you all for joining alongside me this morning and a little bit of laughter. But we are here to worship God. We are here to praise him and give him thanks for all that he has done for us. We want to remember as we enter into worship today that our brothers and sisters around the conference, a special annual conference was held yesterday, and the ordination service is going on now up in Wesleyan for those that are being commissioned and ordained. So we want to keep them in our prayers as well. As it is a special day, a little different day than they anticipated, but a special day nonetheless. But today is the day that the Lord has made, so let us rejoice and give thanks in it, and let us go now to the Lord in prayer. God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for being able to gather together, whether remotely or here in person. We give you thanks. So as we prepare our hearts and our minds for this time set apart for worship, we give you all the glory for it all. Be with us, dwell with us, open us up to what you have for us today. As we hear the songs, as we hear the lessons, and as we hear from our special guest this day, open us up to hearing what you've called us to do. Lord, we love you and we thank you. And again, he has risen. In your son's name, we give thanks and pray this day. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you all here this morning and see those smiling eyes anyway. So today I have a basket. It's my purse basket. Well, really, it's my mom's purse basket, but nonetheless. And I've got some stuff in here. Like, I know, what would you keep in your purse? Maybe your phone, maybe your keys. But in this story, there was something else in a basket. Maybe a basket a little bit like this. So the person with this basket had heard that Jesus was coming to the area. Even though Jesus was trying to have like a little alone time with his friends because he heard something terrible had happened, a whole crowd of people heard that Jesus was coming and they gathered to see him. And Jesus, even though he was tired and sad and just probably weary, he felt bad for these people. His heart moved for these people. So he preached and he healed and he prayed and he taught all of these people many, many things. And as he kept teaching and teaching, the disciples start looking around and they're like, Jesus, it's lunchtime. We are far away from any kind of food. Some people were like, let's just send them out. Some other disciples are like, we don't have enough money for this. And Jesus says, don't worry, there will be food. Now, this story is special because it's in all four of the Gospels. And if you read it out of John, you will see that somebody found not a big strong man or a mom with all of her supplies, but a little boy with a basket full of two fish and five loaves of bread. Now, that seems like a big lunch for a little boy, but he might have had a mom kind of like me, where I was like, you never know what you're going to want to eat today. Maybe you're going to want more bread. Maybe you're going to need more fish. Maybe you need to share it with your friend. Let me just give you two whole fish and five whole loaves of this bread, and you can just, you know, share it if somebody else is hungry. Little did that little boy know how much this fish and bread would help that day. It was the only food there for a crowd with 5,000 men plus women and children. So who knows what the real total was. And this was the only food to be seen in the area. Imagine how that little boy felt. He had to be mighty brave to go up in front of this large crowd and say, here's some food. You can use it if you want. And he did. And Jesus prayed over the food and he broke it. And I imagine he just started passing it. He broke a piece off and passed it, and broke a piece off and passed it, and broke a piece off and kept passing it, and kept passing it, and kept passing it. And everybody in the crowd not only got something to eat, but was satisfied with what they had eaten. And then Jesus says, go get the extras. That sounds crazy. There were 12 baskets full of extra food. So when you set out with maybe just a little extra in your basket for your day, you never know how Jesus can turn it into something amazing. All right, guys, let's bow our heads. Let's say a prayer. Dear God, help us to carry with us what we need to share your love wherever we go. Make sure that we have a little extra in our baskets so that we can share your love and your grace and your joy and your faith and your mercy with all of our friends, and maybe some strangers too. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
At this time, we have the privilege of hearing from our special guest speaker, Miss Amy Carr. I first met Amy about 5 years ago on our way to Vassar, Michigan for my first Reach mission trip, and she is here to share with us today the calling she has into missionary work. And she is one of the people that I brought back on the trip. Usually you guys always ask when I take kids to mission trips, do I bring them back? Yes, she is back.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I hope everyone's doing good. It's awesome to be here. I'm very appreciative of Pastor Ed and Jeremy just for all their support they've shown me and for giving me the opportunity to tell my story to you guys today. I kind of just wanted to share my testimony because Forest Burdette has made a huge impact in my life and to how I actually became a full-time missionary and what I'm going to be doing with my upcoming mission work to Brazil. And so I was extremely involved with the youth. I was in the youth from about 2010 to 2015. And so any youth event, I would go to it with just kind of starting my story on how I came to Forest Burdette. I didn't really grow up going to church religiously. I kind of went like here and there, but I didn't really understand what it meant to have a true relationship with God. And so I had a friend invite me to a youth night at Forest Burdette, and I went and absolutely fell in love with it and started going every single Wednesday and then on all the youth events and then on Sundays and just became extremely involved. And that's when I ended up going on my first mission trip. That's a picture from Reach, through Reach Work Camps with Forest Burdette back in 2011. And during this trip to, we went to South Carolina and we went to this woman's house. She was about in her 50s and she wasn't married. She didn't have kids. She didn't have a lot of family left. She was missing a leg, and so it was harder for her to get around, and she only had a small bed to sleep, or a small couch to sleep on. She didn't have a bed, but despite all of her hardships, she was one of the kindest people I had ever met in my entire life, and she was absolutely just faith-filled and filled with joy and appreciation, and she would just join us through all of our Bible studies we would have every lunch, and was one of just the most kindest people ever. Which was really impactful, especially for young youth, to see how many people need help, like even in our neighborhoods around us. And so that was just really the spark of, I feel like this is something I could be doing. And then I end up going on two more mission trips through Reach Work Camps with Forest Burdette. And I end up just joining Overland Missions. I was looking for organizations and how I kind of got to that point. I went through the mission trips with Reach, and then I started to go to college. When it came to me actually going to college, I was just kind of putting missions on the back burner and told myself, like, no, who are you to do missions? You know, you're not perfect. And I told myself that I needed to get a career, get an education, which are great things to have. And so I kind of just put missions on that back burner, and I started working full time and started going to school full time. And throughout the several years since my very first mission trip, I felt God pulling on my heart saying, you're supposed to be doing missions. And I would talk to friends about it every single year. And when it came to me actually graduating with a bachelor's degree in 2018, I felt the pull even more and felt like God was saying to me, okay, like now you have your career, because I've been working as a paralegal for about 3 years at that point at a law firm. And he said, now you have your education. What's your excuse for me now? You know, are you fulfilled? And I just kind of sat back and was like, oh my gosh, you're right. And just imagine myself at the end of my life, what I would regret not doing. And missions was the very first thing that came to mind. And, you know, I realized that I was fearful of leaving behind friends and family and the job that I had, just really essentially everything I was comfortable with. Because when God calls you to step outside your comfort zone, you know, you're stepping into the unknown. But that's when he blesses you the most and where you see him provide and where you see him just be so faithful for your obedience. And so I realized that though I was fearful of that I was more scared of not doing missions because I felt like I'd be missing out on my purpose. And so I kind of just accepted. I was like, God, you know, I give it to you. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do missions, so please guide me. And once I just accepted that I was actually going to do it, I just felt this huge weight lift off my shoulders, and that's when I started seeing all these opportunities open up and meeting new people and connecting with churches and just finding out eventually about Overland Missions, which is the missions agency I'm with. And that's the time I was praying for, you know, which mission organization should I go with, because there's so many. And it actually so happened that I found out about this through a mutual friend of a couple of my best friends who were youth pastors at the time, and while searching for a missions organization. So perfect timing, which God's timing's always perfect. And so I just researched him and prayed about it, and found that they had an advanced mission training in Zambia, Africa for 3 months to help prepare you for full-time mission work and to do village ministry. And so I just felt like they were right, and I signed up to go with them and started fundraising. And God completely provided it all, because I had no clue how to fundraise. And when it actually came to a couple months before I was going to Zambia, Africa, I was walking around in my room just kind of praying and asking God for confirmation that Zambia was the right place for me to go, and because there's so many countries that need help. And I remember stopping to look at this little bird that has always been sitting on my dresser for the past several years. And I actually got this bird when I went to a Christian music festival with Forrest Burdett called Igthus, right after my first mission trip. And there's tons of booths at this music festival that are fundraising for nonprofits or organizations or different countries. And I just remember going to this one booth, and they were selling these birds for a group of women in a certain country. And I was like, yes, like, I love to support that. And so I got a bird, and it's been on my dresser ever since. And so when I was praying for confirmation, I just randomly stopped to look at this bird in my room, and I'm like, man, I wish I could remember what country this came from. And I looked down and flipped over the tag, and it said Zambia on it, which was the exact country that I was going to start my missions journey. And so there's the bird with the Zambia tag. But so I was absolutely ecstatic, and I was just, I was praising God because he had given me such a strong confirmation. And I felt like he was saying in that moment, you know, this is the right path I have for you. You're going the right way. And it's kind of been sitting in front of your face all these several years. and so this verse said this really, just kind of my testimony of him chasing after me and not giving up on me for missions. It's Proverbs 19:21. Many are the plans in a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. And so I feel like that just strongly speaks of that he's not going to give up on us, and he has a purpose for us. And so with actually fast forwarding to going into Zambia, Africa, I get to Zambia, and I get to go through tons of different classes to train as a full-time missionary. But most importantly, we got to do a lot of village ministry. And I was just absolutely mind blown, really, when we went to our first village called Salumbwe, and we had gotten there, and there were hundreds of people there that hadn't even heard of who Jesus was at all. And this just really put an urgency in my heart, and just really stirred my heart for just, wow, there are so many people that hadn't heard of Jesus, who Jesus is. There are people that don't know who to turn to when things get hard in their lives. And I couldn't imagine not having God to turn to when things get hard, when I need strength, when I need comfort, when I need a provider, a friend, a father, and that they didn't know about him. And so that just really put an urgency in my heart of how many people need reach. And so one of my favorite testimonies from that trip, among many, is a story of Lobita. And I love to tell this testimony because it's so powerful. We were actually traveling to a town called Mwanambao, just to run errands for the day. We didn't have any ministry plans. And we're driving to the town just to help out a local Zambian pastor with some errands for the day that we were working with. And our leader felt led to stop at one of another leader's disciples' huts. And so we drove out to the hut, and we get there, and we quickly find out that this the disciple's wife named Lobita was really sick. and that she had been sick for a couple months at this point. And so we were like, oh my gosh, like we need to pray for her. And but we found out quickly that she had left just a couple hours beforehand by a cart driven by an ox to go to a nearby town to visit a prophet for prayer. But this prophet charged for prayer, and so we knew this wasn't a true man of God because prayer is free. And so we were like, we were going to find her. We were going to pray for her. She does not need to pay for prayer. And so we drove around the bush of Africa just for hours trying to find her ox cart. And we get to this midway village that's supposed to be a resting point for oxes. And the villagers weren't aware of her whereabouts, so we were trying to decide if we should continue on to that town or if we should keep driving around. And while we were talking, the villagers said, well, we have sick people in our village. Can you pray for our people? And we were like, yeah, of course, and prayed for their people. And then a woman was there from another village down the road and said, can you walk down to my village and pray for my people? And we were like, yeah, and followed her down to her village. And we get there and we pray over several people. And I just remember this woman who, she was probably in her 30s, and she had to walk with a stick because she had some problems with her legs. And she has asked for us to pray over her legs, pray over her faith. And we pray for her, and then afterwards she stands up to test out her legs, and she starts walking and throws down her stick and walks with no problem at all. And we were just like, praise God, because, you know, he's a God of miracles, and he's the same God as he was yesterday, as he is today and tomorrow. And so it was amazing. And we saw miracles like this and people being transformed and hearts being brought to God all throughout the 3 months. And we started walking back to the Midway village, and the villagers are following us, just dancing and singing and praising Jesus. And we walk up to the Midway village, and we see Libita pull up in her ox cart at that exact moment, which we were just amazed at God's perfect timing, because if we would have continued on, we would have completely missed Libita, and we would have missed praying for all these people. And so it was just an awesome reminder that, you know, especially with ministry, that it's God's agenda and that it's not our own. And so we just run up to her and we're like, oh my gosh, we've been searching for you. We want to pray for you. And we pray over her and encourage her because she had been sick for that couple months. So she was kind of down in her spirits. And we just tell her that, you know, God wants you healed, that he wants you encouraged, and that he's there for you. And after we had prayed, she said that she felt 100 times better and that she didn't want to go to the prophet anymore. And so we were able to actually, it was her and her husband and two children. So we were able to all kind of pack up in our car and drive them back to their hut. And when we get there, we actually have a big bag of what's called shema with us. And we never have extra food with us, but shema is a very staple meal in Zambia, and it will provide for a family for a long time. It's a type of grain. And so we give that to them, and they were like, oh my gosh, we haven't eaten in 5 days. Like, thank you so much. And we were just once again amazed, because that's another way of God providing for them. And just throughout the 3 months, or the whole day, I just kept thinking of leaving the 99 for the one, which is Luke 4-7. This is Libita and her family too, her two kids and her husband. But Luke 15:4-7, suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. And so I just kept thinking of this verse the whole day, because he was leaving the 99 for the one, and just showing his unconditional love and faithfulness. And it was just an awesome day of unplanned ministry and blessings. And Just throughout the 3 months, we just saw testimonies like that. We saw people encouraged. We saw hundreds of people give their life to Jesus. Village Ministry is just camping out and walking miles and miles, hut to hut, not really knowing where you're going, but kind of just stopping at any hut you come across and working with our translators on figuring out where huts are from footprints on these little off-roads. And they were strong ministers of the gospel too, and so it was awesome to have them on our team. And we just saw hundreds of people give their life to Jesus, hundreds of people encouraged, hundreds of people healed, and just really a powerful move of God throughout the entire 3 months. And while I was in Zambia, God just really put on my heart to do missions in South America. And so I joined Overland Missions full-time, and I ended up signing up to go onto their Brazil team. We have a team in Brazil, and so I kind of wanted to show you just a short video of who Overland Missions is, so you get a better visual and understanding on the team that I'm with.
Year 2018 was a breakthrough year for Overland Missions. We have missionaries pioneering, evangelizing, and discipling in more countries than ever before. Our team in Brazil is pushing into the heart of the rainforest on riverboats, discipling future leaders along the Amazon River. In Zambia alone, we have 15 active sectors, leading revival meetings, leadership training, chief chaplaincy, and discipleship. We witnessed thousands of people giving their lives to Christ this year. In 2018, we graduated the most AMT students ever from our Rapid 14 base. The Mukubal people of Angola are experiencing God's love and power that comes with the gospel, bringing restoration to families and communities. Through prayer, our God has brought rain to the end of the drought that plagued the land for over a decade. Our Mozambique team has overcome challenge after challenge, but this year they led their first expedition in the country and are preparing for the first ever AMT class outside of Zambia. After nearly a decade of work, Overland is primed to establish a base in DR Congo, learning the language and building relationships. Even in a place that's over 90% Muslim, the team in Tanzania is expanding exponentially with indigenous believers. They are seeing God open doors and push back the darkness in incredible ways. Our team in Southeast Asia pioneered more areas than ever in 2018. In Cambodia alone, we launched 6 different expeditions into the 2 main sectors, bringing the gospel to remote villages. People are seeing dreams and visions of God. The Cambodian people are hungry like never before. Despite the difficulties in areas of North Africa and the Middle East, people are eager to hear the true gospel. In the last year, our team has seen huge success, building relationships and seeing the miraculous.
But it all starts with packing that backpack and going over there.
And so Overland Missions is an interdenominational nonprofit missions organization, and they've been doing missions for about 20 years, are in 14 different countries, and I chose to go to Brazil because God put South America on my heart, and their main goal is to reach the remote, the hard to reach villages, the indigenous communities that have not heard of who Jesus is or have scarcely heard of who Jesus is, don't have people there continually building up into their faith. And so my goal is to go to Brazil for the next 5 years, and I'll be doing missions full-time in Brazil, and my goal is to see leaders build up, to see disciples made, to see these communities just a ripple effect made for the kingdom, and these ministers build up in these communities. So when you're there long-term and you're continually meeting with these leaders and disciples and seeing their faith build up and the word of God just spread throughout the community, that you just see this community be built up and strong ministers made so that when you go to a new village that you have that community already strong in their faith and that you have connections with them and really just see that ripple effect made for the kingdom and people stepping out into their callings and seeing the relationship that they have with God and that God wants with them and how much that he loves them. And so I believe that the nation of Brazil is going to be impacted with Jesus, that it's going to be shaken with the gospel, that people's hearts and minds are going to be stirred, and that the love of Jesus is going to reach people and transform people. I'll be in the first year learning Portuguese from 6 to 9 months, so I'll be my own translator, and there won't be any language barrier. And then after I learn the language, I'll move on to a houseboat full-time and live in the Amazon, where there's those hundreds of remote indigenous villages that are hard to reach, that can only be reached by boat, that hadn't heard of who Jesus is and that need to know who he is because of the love that he wants to have with them. And so they have someone to turn to and have a father and a friend and that provider and just know how much that he loves them and cares for them. And so right now I am focusing on building up a prayer and financial team. And so my goal right now is to build up a team on a monthly or once per year basis. And so I kind of have a chart broken down, and I've had actually a few people sign up this week. So I only need 21 partners on my team now, which is awesome. And so I have to have my team build up of partners before I can actually leave for Brazil. I am hoping to leave this August, so by the end of August. They just opened up the borders a couple of days ago on July 29th, and so I'm absolutely ready and excited to be there and to see God move. And so if you feel in your heart that you're able to join my team, that you want to join my team and seeing the unreached reached in Brazil, then I would absolutely love to have you on my team. It would be a blessing. And so I just want to thank you guys again for allowing me to speak. As I mentioned before, Forest Burdette has made a huge impact on my life. This is where I found my relationship with Jesus. This is where I was extremely involved in the youth all throughout high school. And this is where I did confirmation class. I got baptized. So Forest Burdette has made such a huge impact in my life. And it really means so much to me to be able to get up here and share my story with you guys of just how God has moved in my life and how he had never given up on me and chased after me to do missions, which I'm forever thankful for. And I'm just grateful for the opportunity to share this story with you guys and the missions that I'll be doing in Brazil. I also have a blog if you want to stay updated with just what's happening in missions called verticallyliving.com. And so on there you can sign up as a partner too for a partner online, but I also have a table in the back where I'll have different forms or different things so you can stay updated with my missions or learn more about my missions. And so I would absolutely love to talk to you, but thank you again for listening, and just Pastor Ed for giving me the opportunity to speak up here. So thank you so much.
As Amy said, she has information in the narthex when you leave today. If you want to partner with her, that is fantastic. We'll have a video that we shot previously that we'll share on our Facebook page, so you can share with and watch it again and learn more about the awesome stuff that God's doing. And it's just a blessing to see and to hear that someone invited Amy to church and all of this that God has done through that. That as a pastor, that speaks volume as to what the community of God can do. And I just give him thanks for that, and we'll continue to pray for Amy and her team, and just give God the glory for it. Don?
Like the woman at the well, I was seeking for things that could not satisfy. And then I heard my Savior speaking, draw from my well that never shall run dry. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up and make me whole. There are millions in this world who are craving the pleasures earthly things afford, but none can match the wondrous treasure that I find in Jesus Christ my Lord. Fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up and make me whole. So my brother, if the things this world gives you leave hungers that won't pass away, my blessed Lord will come and save you if you'll kneel to him and humbly pray. Fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up and make me whole. Fill my cup, Lord. Fill my cup. Amen.
Thank you, Don, and thank you, Amy, for sharing with us. We come now to a time of sharing our joys and concerns, and I do want to ask that we remember Marianne Norman McClure's daughter, Vicky. She had a little bit of a letdown this week. She was all set for her transplant surgery, and then it kind of fell apart at the last minute. But please keep her in your prayers. I know she would appreciate that, and Marianne and Norman would appreciate that as well. We also want to lift up Ellis this morning. He's going to be having knee replacement surgery this week. And Ellis, you are in our prayers, and we will keep you in our prayers through this time for a quick and speedy recovery. And also, we've had an anonymous request here on our website for a much-needed miracle, and God understands and knows this need, and so we're going to lift that to the Lord today and trust the Lord to meet this need and bring this miracle that is so much needed. Please continue to keep Jim Swan in your prayers. Jim was in the hospital last week for a short stay with a kidney infection, but he's doing much better now from that. And also remember their daughter Kathy in your prayers. I know they would greatly appreciate that as well. And I just want to ask that all of us be in prayer for Amy as she is preparing to go to Brazil. It is such a blessing that right from this church, we see how God is working, and Amy, we are praying for you and praying that God will just open the right doors for this ministry and that you will accomplish great things while there for the sake of Jesus Christ. So let's keep her in our prayers, and I wonder if anyone has any unspoken requests today by an uplifted hand. Just say, pray for me or pray with me as I'm praying for others. Will you join me in prayer? Almighty God, what a blessing it is to come before you this day. Truly, if not another word was spoken this day, we've already been blessed beyond measure by this wonderful, inspiring word from Amy and from Don's song, Mike's playing, all these things, Janae's children's moments, and for Jeremy leading us. We are so blessed to be a part of this service today. Whether we are here in person or at home or somewhere else. And I ask, Lord, that you will open our hearts in this time, that we might find ourselves drawing nearer to you and finding that inner peace, that inner strength that we all need, that we might live our lives in such a way that we'll be a blessing to others, and that we will truly serve you each and every day. Thank you, Lord, for all those who are present, whether here in person or in their homes. And today we do want to lift up Vicki and ask that you will surround her with your loving arms, give her the assurance that in your time, everything will be taken care of for her, and we will witness a great miracle in her life. We pray for Ellis this morning and ask that you will touch his life as he prepares for this surgery. And we trust and pray that it will not only go well, but he will have a full and speedy recovery as well. Thank you for his life, his friendship, and his ministry, not just here, but all across this annual conference. And Lord, for this request for a miracle, Lord, we don't know details, but you do. And we believe in our hearts that you will meet this need in a very special way. And I ask, Lord, your continued prayers for Jim Swan, and for Kathy, and I ask you will just surround them with your loving arms this day and every day, giving them that sweet assurance of your presence and your healing touch. Now, Lord, as we pray together a prayer that you taught us to pray, our hearts rejoice this day that we can share in this prayer together, because it truly blesses our hearts every time we say these words. These are the words that Jesus taught us to pray when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's scripture comes from Matthew chapter 14, verses 13 through 21. Would you hear these words this morning, church? Now when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them, and he cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." And they replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men besides women and children. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
This truly has to be one of the great miracles of Jesus' ministry. The feeding of the 5,000 is not only a great miracle, it is one of those times in which we are reminded of the beauty and the importance of compassion in our hearts, and sometimes a need for a deeper faith. Jesus has just heard the news about the killing of John the Baptist. His heart has to be broken at that point. And he wants to go off by himself to a remote place where he can just pray and think and reflect. After all, John is his cousin. John is the one who prepared the way for his coming. John is the one who introduced him to this world. And so Jesus gets in a boat and he goes off to a remote place where he feels that he might be able to just be alone for a while and think and reflect and pray. Even grieve. Remember, though, this is Jesus, and by now he has blessed many people with his healings, he has blessed many people with his words, and wherever he has gone, he has attracted large crowds. And so the crowd, seeing him leaving, begin to follow him on foot. They would have made a considerable effort just to find Jesus and be near him once again. And when Jesus saw them coming, he had compassion for them. And he began to reach out to them in only a way he can do. And he began to heal the sick among them. And the people were grateful. And this went on all day long. All day long. It's now evening. It's late. And the disciples come to Jesus and say, "Lord, you need to send these people away. They need to go into the villages where they can buy food and have something to eat." And then Jesus does something remarkable here. He simply looks at his disciples and he says, "You feed them." By now they're scratching their heads and wondering, has he gone mad? Is he crazy? Is he off his rocker? What's he thinking here? And they start looking around and they find a little boy who has 5 loaves and 2 fish. And they'll say to Jesus, "This is all we can find. 5 loaves and 2 fish. Little do they know who they're talking to in many ways. This is Jesus, right? And Jesus simply takes the 5 loaves and 2 fish and blesses them. and starts to distribute them to his disciples. All the people are seated on the ground now, and the disciples will carry around these loaves and fish, and they will feed everyone until they are absolutely full. And when they are filled, they'll go back out and collect the leftovers. We all like leftovers, don't we? I eat leftovers frequently in my house. We love leftovers, and there are 12 baskets of leftovers after all those people have been fed. 5,000 men, not counting women and children. So who knows how many were there? We can only speculate. 20,000 maybe? Who knows? In everything that Jesus does, there is a purpose. And one of the things I've learned about our Lord is that everything he does to glorify God and to perhaps teach us an important lesson. So whether it's a great miracle like this or one of the parables or whatever the case might be, Jesus always desires to glorify God and take the moment to teach a lesson. And in this particular scene, there's a great lesson that is taught from Jesus himself by his very example. Remember, Jesus went to this remote place for what reason? To be alone, to grieve, to pray, to reflect. And yet this great crowd followed him. And what does Jesus do? He has compassion on them. He sees their hearts and he thinks in his mind, you know what? If these people are willing to follow me to such lengths, even to such a remote place, the least I can do is minister to them. The least I can do. And so he begins to reach out to them, setting aside his own need to be alone, to pray and reflect in that moment. He sets aside everything that he came there to do in order to meet the needs of those present with him. Dear friends, that's compassion. What would this world look like today if more people were willing to set aside, even for a short time, the needs of their own lives to meet the needs of others? Would this world look a little different today? What if more of us were willing to set aside our own needs for a spell, just so we could meet the needs of others? Wouldn't this community look a little different today? I'm not saying we don't have needs. We all have needs. We have pressing needs sometimes. We have things that we're dealing with in our lives, and I'm not suggesting that we forget about those things. But once in a while, it does our hearts good just to set aside our own wants, our own wishes, our own desires, just long enough to meet the need of someone else. Because you never know what a blessing that might become. You never know what something as simple as an invitation to come to a place like Forest Burdett can do. We saw that here this morning. So I want to encourage all of us to have hearts filled with compassion for others. I want to encourage us to be a compassionate, loving people that's willing to even set our own needs aside for a little while to meet the needs of others. But there's another important lesson learned here in this, and that has to do with faith. Now, the disciples will discover very quickly that their faith is really put to the test in many ways. Because in normal circumstances, 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish aren't going to go very far in a crowd like that, right? Maybe a few people on the front row might get fortunate enough to get a little bite of something. But to feed, who knows, 20,000 people with 5 loaves and 2 fish, it seems impossible. So the disciples will struggle with this just a bit. But let's remember who's asking them to feed the crowd. It's Jesus. And I learned a long time ago in my life that all things are possible with God. Do you believe that today? All things are possible with God. And these disciples learned in that short amount of time a whole lot more about who Jesus is. And they learned a valuable lesson, that all things truly are possible with God, and that would impact their ministries for the rest of their lives. They didn't maybe even pick up on it at the moment, but it would truly have an impact on them for the rest of their lives. There are times in our lives that our faith can be challenged, right? We look at something and it just looks like a great mountain, and we don't know how to scale it. We don't know how to deal with it. We don't know what to say or do. But I remind you here today that the Scripture teaches us that all things are possible with God. Now, I'll admit, I'm human. And as a human, I'm weak. I can look at something and say, there's no way. I can look at something and say, I don't know how I'm going to deal with this one. I can look at something and say, I don't have a clue what the answer is. And yet I'm reminded that there are times when I have to take my faith to another level. Now, I believe all of you here have faith in God, right? And I believe all of you watching out there have faith in God, but sometimes we need to take it to another level. We need to be able to say, Lord, I'm just going to be honest with you. I don't know what to do here. I don't know what the answer is. I don't know how to deal with this. But I believe you do. And I'm going to trust you. And I'm going to put my faith in you to believe that no matter what circumstance, no matter what situation we find ourselves in, you are going to be there and you are going to get us through this. You don't know, dear friends, how many times in my life I've had to look at the Lord and say, okay, Lord, I just have to turn it over to you because I don't know what to do here. But praise God, we serve a Savior who loves us and cares for us. We serve a God in which nothing, nothing is impossible. We can be assured that even in our weakness, God is strong. Amen? In our weakness, God is strong. And today, we learn from a lesson. A little boy with 5 loaves and 2 fish, willing to share, that all things are possible with God. And if you're willing to put your trust in God, God will never let you down. Now we're going to have a closing hymn. And after, and during this time, I'm going to invite you to just join me in a time of prayer. I believe it's important that we, the church, be praying. We have a lot to pray for today, don't we? And maybe you find yourself here this morning struggling a little bit, saying, boy, you're right. There's been so many times in my life I didn't know what to say or do. But thank the Lord this day. There's someone we can turn to who is bigger than you and I. Someone who can meet our needs. Someone who can minister to us. Someone who can even do the impossible. So this morning, as we hear this beautiful hymn, will you join me in prayer and allow God to speak to your heart this day in a very special way? Mike. Amen. It's been a great place to be, and I want to thank Amy again for sharing with us. And Amy, I'm going to invite you to slip on back there to your table so folks can greet you and talk to you about the mission trip and everything. So if you'd like to do that, you're welcome. And as she's doing that, I want to just offer this word of encouragement to support Amy with your prayers, and if you're able to support her financially in some way, that would be a tremendous gift to her as well. So anyway, thank you for coming. Thank you for being with us this day, wherever you are. And I want to just offer this prayer and we'll be dismissed. Thank you, O God, for your love and for your patience with us and for the joy that you bring to our hearts. Lord, there are times when we realize how important it is to set aside our own needs, even if it's just for a little while, to meet the needs of others. Help us, Lord, to be a compassionate people. Help us, Lord, to deepen our faith. And when we find ourselves being challenged because we don't know what to do or what to say, help us always to remember that you're still there for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you and God bless you.